Before we dive into the sermon this morning, you know, just reflecting on that video for a second, I hope you all feel and have the sense, as we talk about generosity and what's in front of us, for us, it's coming from two places. One is it's coming from a vision that we believe God has given us to reach our neighbors. And we can't help but sort of talk about that. But two, it's coming from a place that, just as you heard, just a generous God who's been so generous to us and the opportunity that he invites us in, whether that's relational as we share our time and emotions with people or financial or however it presents itself. We never want to talk about it in a way that is manipulative or guilt-driven. It's out of who God is, what he's done for us. And we celebrate that. I'm going to pray for us, and then we'll dive in. Would you pray with me? Father, as we've already expressed this morning, I pray that you would continue to meet us in this place and that we would be aware of your presence. Lord, as we look into your word, remind us again that you invite us into relationship with you. Open our eyes to the call that you've placed in our lives and give us the strength to follow in that. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You know, if you have like a favorite TV series or show or whatever that you watch, how oftentimes if it's a new season of that show or a new, even sometimes just from episode to episode, they'll say something like previously on Downton Abbey or whatever, you know. We're going to take a moment here just to kind of start there, because we have been, as a church, we've been looking at this story of God, immersed in this narrative, the story that God has been writing from the very beginning of time. We've seen how it is a story of pursuit, of pain and conflict, and a story of redemption. It's a story that began in beauty, where God's creative activity is on display, where God's character is being revealed in his glory, where humanity is formed out of the dust of the ground and they're living in perfect harmony and perfect alignment with God's story. And then there's disruption. The story takes this violent turn for the worse as sin and rebellion enter the picture. There's this collective, as we study this, there's almost this collective because we feel it, we experience it. My 8-year-old daughter, when she had the flu just this winter, middle of the night, and I'm trying to give her some more ibuprofen to bring down her temperature, her sad little pale face looked and said, "Why did Adam and Eve have to eat the fruit?" I said, "I don't know, honey." So this once perfectly designed, perfectly aligned relationship has now experienced brokenness and separation. There's grief and sorrow and loss and death has now entered the picture. The pinnacle of God's creative activity, humankind, in our ability to be in a relationship with our Creator, is now marred by this willful rejection of God's provision. So the storyline kind of follows two tracks from that point. On the one hand, we see this progression, this continual development, this escalation of sin. Things go from bad to worse. Sin is always on the advance. It's always seeking to claim new ground and to wreak havoc, and everyone is feeling the impact of it, from the least to the greatest. Things are not good. But they are just alongside of this painful narrative. God is at work. Despite the rejection, despite all that has happened, God has not abandoned us. He has not given up on us. God is working in the midst of the chaos, and he is working to restore that which has been lost. So God comes and he establishes a covenant with Abraham, a covenant which he says, this is going to be a blessing to all the families on earth. And through this family, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, these four men who are following after God, God sees the need of humanity, a need for sanctification, a need for you and I to be called his sons and daughters for our ultimate redemption. And God would act. The book of Genesis, and I believe Pastor Jeff pointed this out last week, it ends with four words: a coffin in Egypt. These two realities are there simultaneously. One, we see the reality of death because of sin. But in the midst of it, there's hope, because God continues to provide a way back. This brings us now to our study of the book of Exodus. Exodus follows Genesis in much the same way that the New Testament follows the Old. If Genesis retells the story of humanity's failure in every test, in every condition, then Exodus is this thrilling epic of a God coming to the rescue. It tells the redeeming work of a sovereign God. Exodus is preeminently a book of redemption in the Old Testament. It begins in dark and gloom and captivity, and it ends in glory. It tells how God came down in order to redeem an enslaved people. And it ends by declaring how God came down in his glory in order to dwell amongst a redeemed people. The word Exodus is a Greek word that literally means the way out. And this is exactly what God is going to do. He is going to provide once again a way out. Would you turn with me to Exodus chapter 3? We're going to pick up where Pastor Jeff left off last week after we were introduced to Moses and to the people of God, Israel, in Egypt now, in enslavement. We're going to pick up with this familiar passage where Moses encounters God again. It says, "Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in the flame of a fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning, and yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, 'I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned.' When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, 'Moses, Moses.' And he said, 'Here I am.' Then he said, 'Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground.' And he said, 'I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob.' And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, 'I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites, the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. And now, behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh that I may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt.' But Moses said to God, 'Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?' And he said, 'But I will be with you, and this shall be a sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain.' Then Moses said to God, 'If I come to the people of Israel and I say to them, "The God of our fathers has sent me to you," and they ask me, "What is his name?" what shall I say to them?' God said to Moses, 'I am who I am.' And he said, 'This say to the people of Israel, "I am has sent me to you." God also said to Moses, 'Say this to the people of Israel: The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations.'" Moses' life is about to drastically change. And it all begins here in the midst of what we're calling the encounter. The encounter. D.L. Moody once said of Moses that Moses spent 40 years thinking he was somebody. Then he spent 40 years on the backside of the desert realizing he was nobody. And finally, he spent the last 40 years of his life learning what God can do with a nobody. This encounter here with God in the burning bush is going to mark this sort of third portion of Moses' life. Remember now, Moses has been raised in the home of Pharaoh. He's had every advantage, every luxury available to him. Now he's working for his father-in-law as a shepherd in the middle of the desert. And things have changed for him pretty dramatically over the course of his life, and now they're about to change once again as he encounters God. There's a couple aspects of this encounter here that I want us to pay attention to. And first, the significance of this is recognized just in the significance of God's presence. The significance of his presence. Have you ever, anyone in the room ever been starstruck? Ever been so close to like a celebrity or anything that you just kind of clammed up? Anyone? Literally just me. Okay, thank you. I appreciate it. Yes. I one time when I was a young youth pastor, I just graduated from Moody maybe a year or two, and on the Moody campus, we had the Solheim Center, which was our athletic center. And it was a pretty nice facility. And so the NBA would host their pre-draft camp there. So college players that want to be drafted into the NBA come and run drills there and scrimmage and do all these things. And all the execs from the NBA will watch them and evaluate them, essentially. So I had a buddy who was worked at the Solheim Center, and he said, hey, why don't you come down and you can work the pre-draft camp and bring some of your students with it. They're going to love being around all these potential NBA players. And it was great. So I brought a few guys down that I'd kind of been building relationships with. And we were down there. And at this time, Michael Jordan was an executive with the Washington Wizards. He was the GM of the team. And all these college players are in there, and we're just like shagging the balls, throwing them back to them. They're shooting. And we're loving it. We're having a great time. And in the middle of this, Michael Jordan walks into the building. And it was, to use an Exodus phrase, like the Red Sea split. There was a almost, you could tangibly feel the weight of his presence. The whole room turned. And I know this is in Chicago, this is the epicenter of where he did what he did, but the whole building recognized the presence of Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan was in the space, and as he walked down the hall, it moved for him. It was like nothing I have ever seen in my life. And here now, Moses is feeling the weight of the presence of God. And this becomes more evident to us here shortly, but for our immediate purposes, what we need to recognize, what we need to understand is that this is a transformative moment in the life of Moses. This is the moment when everything changes, and it changes because he encounters God. I think we see the significance, this we experience the weightiness of God's presence in this text in a couple ways. First, there's the flame of the fire. This is going to be this reoccurring manifestation of God's presence throughout the book of Exodus. The God in the flame, his presence in the flame is this physical depiction of his holiness. So Moses in this moment is in the presence of a holy God. And I'm not sure that Moses fully understands or recognizes the significance of this in the moment, but he soon will. Additionally, then, we capture the weightiness of this in this instruction that God gives to Moses to take the sandals off his feet, saying, Moses, you are on holy ground. You are in sacred space. Despite Moses's opportunity here to meet with God, God is calling him in. He desires, and Moses is taking this all in, and yet he's not yet fully recognizing where he's at or who he's with. It's interesting. For years, I led students on missions trips into Ecuador and other places, and one of the things that we would often do with them is give them solo time, particularly in the mountains of Ecuador. Just sometimes a couple hours to go up on the side of the mountain to be with God. We would call that time shoeless. Go be shoeless. Go be in the presence. Intentionally recognize. Encounter God anew. Elizabeth Barrett Browning, the poet, once wrote, "Earth crammed with heaven, and every common bush afire with God. And only he who sees takes off his shoes. The rest sit around and pluck blackberries." Now Moses is becoming aware of God's presence here. And if you think about the most significant or the most transformative moments in your life, in your faith journey, when you think about those, for me, those moments come as I perceive, as I become aware of the presence of God, as I become more attuned into his involvement in my life and just how significant that is. But there's a second sort of component here to understanding this encounter, and that is Moses' response. Moses' response here in verse 6, it says, "And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God." Moses responds by hiding his face. Now think again here for a moment about Moses' life. He's been hiding for the last 40 years. He fled from Egypt because he murdered a man, and now he is standing in the presence of the most holy God. God's holiness, his perfection now stand in stark contrast to Moses' shortcomings. And he responds like we would all respond. He's afraid. This is why he hides his face, because he feels the weight of God's presence. He now stands as one who is unworthy, and he feels ashamed. And this is what I love about this whole thing, this whole encounter that's taking place here, because this is yet another example of God doing what God does, of meeting humankind in the midst of their shortcomings, in the midst of their failures, and forever changing their purpose and their direction. Moses here now encounters the one true God. And it's out of this encounter that everything begins to change. Out of this encounter now, Moses receives the call, and the call leads to the conflict. The call and the conflict. I think is oftentimes the case when you and I or anyone has an encounter with God, it comes with a clear purpose, a call, and Moses' experience is no different. I was thinking about my own story and my own call into ministry, and I've told this story before, but I was a high school student in Albania serving on a short-term mission trip. The conditions, this was shortly after communism had fallen in Albania, and so the country as a whole was 40 to 50 years behind the rest of the world. The conditions were difficult and uncomfortable, uneasy, and yet there was something in the midst of that. And I think this is still part of the reason why we value these experiences for our students so highly. But in the midst of all of this uncomfortableness, my awareness of God's presence, his capacity to speak in my life was increased. I had totally went on that trip thinking I was going to be an architect. And I left that trip saying, okay, God's doing something different. If you were to ask me to place like a call, when God called me into ministry, it was in Albania as a 17-year-old. God is saying, I have something for you. I'm leading you somewhere different than you've yet imagined for yourself. And now Moses is experiencing this as he encounters God. Moses encounters the holy God. And now the course of his life is about to drastically change in ways that he has never previously imagined. So God now gives us the why behind his call on Moses. He says the oppression and the abuse of the people of Israel has continued to escalate. In chapter 2, at the end of chapter 2, verse 24 and 25, it says, "And God heard the groaning and their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God saw the people of Israel, and God knew." That phrase there, "God remembered his covenant," does not mean that God had forgotten and now is recalling it. That phrase is an action phrase. It indicates that God is about to to take action. He is about to work for Israel's benefit, that he is going to keep the covenant that he made with Abraham generations earlier. And I want us to catch this here because I think it's instructive in how we understand and experience God's call in our own lives. God here is saying to Moses, I am going to free my people. I am going to keep my covenant within. And I'm going to use you in the process. We need to understand who the acting agent is. We'll come back to this in a little bit. Moses' response is somewhat unenthusiastic, like it, to say the least. He's standing here in the presence of God. He's having this personal, powerful conversation. God is speaking to him out of a burning bush that does not get consumed. He's been instructed to take off his sandals because he's on holy ground. And Moses stops and responds and says, I don't think I'm the guy for the job. He says in verse 11, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? As a matter of fact, what we have in the remainder of chapter 3 and pretty much all of chapter 4 is a conversation between Moses and God in which Moses is going to continue to express his lack of confidence and his ability to accomplish this call that God is placing on his life, and God patiently reminding Moses that he knows what he's doing. This whole conversation between Moses and God sounds so parental with a child. For those of you that have raised children, have kids in your life, you know exactly what this feels like. I have kids that have a black belt in making excuses. So whatever I can come up with and say, hey, I need you to clean your room, or I need you to put away the dishes, or I need you to put those toys away, or whatever it is, they have this unique ability to say, I can't do that right now, Dad. I've got to do my homework, which, you know, could have been done any time before or any time after. I've got this other thing going on. This isn't going to work for me. Does it sound familiar? It sounds familiar because we've all heard it and we've all done it. There is this uncomfortable boldness that Moses has here as he responds to God. Look again at how Moses responds. In chapter 3, verse 11, he looks essentially at God and he says, well, who am I to do this? I'm not sure that I'm the right guy for the job. But then he sort of flips that conversation. He says, but who are you? In verse 13, who do I say sent me? As we get into chapter 4, he basically says, what if the people don't believe? What if they don't believe that I'm speaking on your behalf? And there's this incredible interaction where God uses the staff of Moses and he turns it into a stake and Moses grabs it by the tail and it's back into a staff, where he looks at his hand and it's covered in leprosy. And then God speaks and it's healed. He says, you're going to take water from the Nile and it's going to turn to blood. But still, Moses is unconvinced. In chapter 4, verse 10, he essentially says, I am not eloquent. I'm slow of speech. I love how God responds there. He says, I made your mouth. I know you, Moses. I know what you're capable of. Lastly, Moses, in this sort of just transparent, authentic, genuine moment with God, says, please, send someone else. Moses doesn't want to go. He doesn't want to go back to Egypt. He doesn't want to disrupt his life. He doesn't want to face his past. Moses doesn't want to go and continues to give God every reason why he shouldn't. And again, all of this feels so familiar because if Moses' sort of response to God represents various kind of categories of how you and I sort of relate to or respond to God's call when he places that in our own lives, if that's the case, then I've used every one of these more than once. I don't want to do that. This is beyond my ability. You got to find somebody better. This is outside of my comfort zone. I'm not sure that I trust you in this. How are the people going to respond? They're going to think I'm crazy, and the excuses go on and on and on. You and I connect to Moses' encounter here with God because for many of us, we've used the very same objections that Moses has used. Think about it even in terms of this neighborhood impact thing that we've been talking about. For some of you, when we start talking about the call to love your neighbor, it was intuitive for you. You thought to yourself, yes, like this comes naturally, and I'm excited that we're doing this. For some of us, we're like, okay, you know, like I see it there, it's technically in the Bible, but this is hard, and you don't know my neighbor, and they're weird, and I'm weird, and so we just start automatically going to that place of why we can't do this, but the problem is we can't escape the call. So in the midst of all of this call and the conflict that results, we discover a solution. And the solution comes in the form of a promise. Comes in the form of a promise. The promise of who God is. Look once again back at verse 13 and 14. It says, then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel. I am has sent me to you. I am has sent me to you. This is an incredibly powerful verse, both then and now, because the response of God is the ultimate answer to every excuse. And remember what we looked at earlier. This is God's activity. This is his work. He's remembered his covenant, and he is now moving to redeem his people. God says to Moses, say to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God now reveals his name as Yahweh. This name so holy and so powerful that the people of Israel were careful to never pronounce it out of fear that they could misspeak his name because they revered it so highly. The name Yahweh is more than a name. The name Yahweh reveals God as the one who is self-existent, who is not dependent on any other. It reveals God as the one who is creator and sustainer. It reveals God as the unchanging one who is complete in every way. It reveals God as the one who is eternal. And it is this God that is placing the call on the life of Moses. And he's ultimately saying to him, look, Moses, what I'm asking from you does not depend on you. It is not dependent on your abilities or what you bring to the table. It's not dependent upon your credentials. The success or failure of the call does not rest on Moses. It is dependent on the one who is the I am. It's dependent on Yahweh. I think as many of you know, I am shortly heading over to the Mill Creek campus to be the campus pastor there. And I am so excited. I in so many ways have felt called and God has been working and moving in my heart and life to lead me that direction. And yet when in my honest moments between you and I, there's a lot of moments when there's fear or there is anxiety or where I'm saying to myself, am I the right guy for this job? Or what if this fails? Or what if the expectations aren't met? Then God, have you put me in? Am I in over my head? Am I capable of that which you're asking me to do? And I'm reminded again here in Moses' encounter with God that it's not about me. It's not dependent upon me. That which God will accomplish, that which he seeks to do, isn't about me or about anybody else. You see, what he asks from you and I is that we be faithful. that we be obedient. And here's the thing that we can't escape. God places a call in our life. Every single one of us, God places, whether that call is specific, like, hey, I want you to go into ministry, or that call is general, hey, I want all of you to love your neighbor, God puts a call in your life. But we're not the ones who accomplish it. We're not the ones that ultimately see it happen. He is. Therein lies our confidence. Therein lies our hope. You see, we connect to this passage because this is us. Because God calls us. And He's the one. He's the one that sees it through. He's the one that ultimately brings it to fruition. And it doesn't mean it's going to be easy. And Moses is about to experience that in very real ways. But it means that he is the one who is ultimately capable, who is ultimately able. But you see, what we discover in Moses, what we discover about the call of God, is that it does not depend on your ability, but rather on your availability. I love that God chose a flawed guy with confidence issues and skeletons in his closet, like literally in his past. He's the guy that God called to a free and oppressed people. Because here's the deal. God is still in the business of freeing enslaved and oppressed people. That's what sin does in our lives. And he is still in the business of using flawed people in the process. That's us. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this encounter that Moses has with you. It reminds us of the power of what happens when we meet with you in very real and personal ways, where we encounter you anew, that our lives are forever changed. Lord, so continue to impress your call upon us as your people, and continue to empower us to give us the courage and the hope that we need to say we'll go, knowing that it's not resolved in us, but in you. Amen. Now receive this morning's benediction. Go now in the name of Jesus Christ, who has called you, who promises to go with you, and is ultimately the one who accomplishes the call. Amen.